Hi, I'm Matthew Burchette, and I thought I'd dress up a little bit for you because this is a luxury edition of Behind the Wings. Now, why is it the luxury edition? Well, first off, we're in our brand new super cool hangar down here at the Boeing Blue Sky Aviation Gallery on Centennial Airport, which is just about 30 minutes south of Denver. But more importantly, bam! That old girl, a DC-3, which was the height of luxury in the 1930s. So stick with us as we get into the where and why and how of the DC-3. So now that we've kind of established where we are and what we're doing, let's talk a little bit more in depth about the DC-3. Now the DC-3 actually is a direct offshoot of the DC-2. Amazing. So the DC-2 was an incredible aircraft, but it was just a little bit too small for the airlines. So in 1934, C.R. Smith of American Airlines went to Douglas and said, hey, design me a much bigger plane. They did, the DC-3. It could carry up to 28 people or 14 in a sleeper compartment. In fact, the very first DC-3s were called Douglas Sleeper Transports, or DSTs. Now, the DC-3 actually did not stay in production very long. In fact, they only made 607 before civilian production was shut down in 1942. Why? World War II. We needed an amazing cargo aircraft. And that's what that old girl turned into, one of the biggest aircraft in World War II. In fact, General Eisenhower attributes the C-47, the Higgins landing craft, and the deuce and a half truck with helping America win World War II. How amazing is that? That's a lot of praise for a plane. I love shiny things. And this old girl is shiny, which is kind of amazing when you consider she was built in 1942, not as a DC-3, but as a C-47, which is actually the military version. But we'll get to some of that later. Look at this. This is an amazing piece of equipment, and it has been lovingly restored. Now, originally, this old girl came equipped with Wright radial 1820s or 1830s. These guys are not quite that. They're a little bit more powerful. With a top speed of just over 200 miles per hour, the DC-3 was literally the lap of luxury for air travelers back in the 1930s and early 40s. You could literally get from one side of the country to the other in one plane, not in one stop, but in one plane. That was a big deal back then. And as we alluded to earlier, this plane could carry 14 passengers in real comfort because you could sleep on the plane. Now, for shorter hops, it could carry up to 28 passengers in seats. And if it was a C-47, it could carry a whole lot of cargo, up to 6,000 pounds, or 28 people, or 18 paratroopers. But let's go take a look at the inside, because that's where it really gets schmancy. I know we're going on the inside, but I want to stop you right here because this door actually makes a lot of sense when you think about it. Remember I told you that this was built in 1942 as a C-47? Well, that means that this tiny little passenger door wouldn't have been there when she was originally built. It actually would have been a split cargo door. In fact, it was so large that you could get a 75 millimeter pack howitzer in here and a bunch of troops to use it. In fact, most of these guys carried up to 18 paratroopers. That's a lot of cargo. But what you really want to see is what the owner has done to the inside of this plane, because it is really amazing. Let's go check it out. How nice is this? This literally was the lap of luxury in the 1930s. And the owner, Brandon, has done an amazing job bringing this back. This plane will seat 14 people, as you can see, in great comfort. Imported fabrics, your own flowers, a nice pull-out table, even a CD player for music. This is really sweet. Now, the paratroopers that flew in these didn't have this kind of luxury. Oh, no, 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 no. They had just a metal bench on either side of the plane, and when they were ready to jump out, they just stood up, hooked up, and out that door they went. You don't really need luxury if you're not going to stay in the plane that long. Let's go check out the cockpit, but before we do that, I'm just going to kind of sit here and enjoy this for a while. I'm going to find somebody to bring me a drink. How amazing is this? I love this cockpit. And one of the things that I really love about it is that it's a combination of both the historic and the modern. So I haven't said it yet, but if in case you haven't figured it out, this plane still flies, and it actually flies quite a bit. In fact, Brandon took it to Oshkosh last year and won an award for his work on this plane. That's how well he's done, you know, and I just love it because you've got all these great original instruments. You've got the mixture and the throttle and the prop pitch levers that are all original, but then you've got an iPad right up here for your navigation, and you've got all your modern radios and all that kind of stuff, but it certainly feels like you're still in an original cockpit, and I just love that about this plane. Now, one of the things you can't really see, but we'll get some B-roll for you, is there's a little door right behind me, and that's actually a crew entry door, and you probably can't see either, but we're kind of high up, so it's not like you can lift yourself in. But the idea was is that if you crammed the back of this thing really full of cargo and the pilots couldn't get in, they could always get in through this door. Now, you don't want to get out from that door because literally right on the other side of it are the spinning propellers. That is not a good thing. We had a dedicated volunteer at the museum who told me a story once. He flew C-47s over the hump. And if you remember correctly, the hump was basically the Himalayas. Well, he was carrying an entire Bailey bridge. There was so many pieces parts in the back of the plane that he couldn't get the door open. So if something went wrong, he really couldn't get out. Now, yeah, he could stop the engines and probably feather the propellers and go out that little door, but that takes a lot of time. So he told me that he just hoped nothing went wrong in his flight over the 30,000 foot peaks of the Himalayas. That's some scary stuff, but you know what? That's why they call them the greatest generation. Hi, I'm Matthew Burchette, and I'm being stopped. Oh, as much as I don't want to, it's time to wrap up this Behind the Wings episode of the Douglas DC-3. Thank you so much for tuning in. And again, as always, please make sure to put questions and comments either on our YouTube channel or our Facebook page, and we will certainly get back to you. Thanks again for tuning in. We love you guys, and stick around because we got cool stuff coming.